might come across as a facetious question, but we've survived partition, fought four wars, countless insurgencies, annexed Kashmir, Nefa, Goa, Pondicherry, imposed AFSPA, POTA, TADA, MISA, hung terrorists, rapists, and murderers, snapped ties with Pakistan, hung on to Kashmir, Arunachal, yet each government, with the exception perhaps of Indira Gandhi's, has been called soft. Explain this to me. I don't know how this works.
In 1947, 1948, when Pakistan tried to occupy Kashmir, we stopped and went to the United Nations, the whole of Jammu and Kashmir, with the result that today Pakistan has a common border with China and we don't have a common border with Afghanistan. We have no strategic sense. And the geopolitical situation would have changed completely if Pakistan did not have a common border with China and we had a common border with Afghanistan. What did you do with China? We ceded all our rights in Tibet. We recognized Tibet as part of China. And China, on the basis of their military of Tibet, is now claiming large parts of territory even today, including Arunachal Pradesh. We've not been able to cope with the problem of terrorism, although we have had experience of Pakistani state-sponsored terrorism for the last 30 years.
So
we have come to a situation where we cannot, in fact, handle Pakistan. Our dialogue with Pakistan, we have a separated dialogue from terrorism. We have agreed that Pakistan is equally a victim of terrorism as us, thereby implying that both of us are equal victims of terrorist forces which are outside the respective controls of the two countries. And then we have muddied the waters further by talking about indigenous terrorism, indigenous groups.
Let me get another perspective on this, which is perhaps a little more sympathetic to the Indian state. Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, Mr. Sibal has made it clear that the outcomes determine the efficacy of not just foreign policy, but how you apply power. And he's pretty much said that we're a soft state. Has your government also abetted?
See, first of all, Rahul, I don't think there's any necessary contradiction between a soft power, which sometimes appears to be a soft state on some issues. We have leveraged India's soft power very well, and we're still leveraging it, and it's had an impact. There certainly would have been cases when, because of the democracy tax we pay, because of the great liberal atmosphere we have in this country, because of media, and also, I think, because we're not a very disciplined country, we appear to be a soft power. Our reactions are sometimes late. Our reactions are measured. We tend to discuss too long, too much, and therefore the outcome does appear to get diffused.
Well,
but I think overall, in 60 years, we have got it right in the end, despite the confusion sometimes created. We haven't really given up anything in a permanent sense to be called a soft state. A soft state is something very different, which doesn't have the eminence, the strength, the stature, the recognition by the rest of the world, which can frequently trample over it.
Mr.
I don't
Prasad,
think that happens to India.
Do you agree with that conception, Mr. Prasad? Because your party today in Parliament has said that there needs to now be a complete shift in foreign policy. We need to invent a new architecture. We are falling off the map.
Well, I don't see any disconnect between a soft power and not being a strong country. India's soft power is because of civilizational heritage, philosophy, yoga, creativity, whatnot. That is beyond the state. We need to recognize that. But certainly, if you give the perception of being a soft country, that you are being kicked by Pakistan, Sri Lanka is uncomfortable, if Maldives also raises eyebrows, then there is something fundamentally wrong. With a huge country like India, extraordinary population, human resources, did not suffer this. And what I would say, history, Mr. Sibal talked about, I would like to talk about the present. What kind of image you convey to the scourge of terrorism being sponsored from across the border? It is there. Governments will have to face it. But I would say, let me give you very one concrete example where I have a serious reservations. The security forces wanted tough law. The Supreme Court validated that tough law. I am talking of POTA. A sponsored campaign came, it is likely to be abused. and the government annuls it. Apprehension of abuse cannot become the basis for annulling any law. Indian Penal Code is there from 1860. In Delhi, the station officer falsely implicates. Income tax law is from 1922. The ITO falsely implicates. You get relief in the higher court. Dowry Prohibition Act is falsely implicating a lot of people, but dowry is a scourge. Now a sponsored campaign is started against a needed law, and it was annulled. When you do these things, you give an indication to the terrorists and their patrons that in India, a sinister sponsored campaign can halt tight action against them. When you do that, you are given an impression or image of India being a soft state. That's my take. And I would urge, finally, because you asked me that question, in case of Pakistan, India needs to outgrow Pakistan. But it's a hard reality being our neighbor. We have to recognize that. There will be no substantial business with Pakistan unless Pakistan changes.
Well, there were contradictions when the NDA was in power. You would admit that. Would resuming talks with Pakistan have meant that once again we were not projecting state power as we should have?
I'm very happy you asked me that question. Yes, I had the privilege to be a minister in Bajpayee government. Mr. Bajpayee called Musharraf. Agra failed because Musharraf failed to acknowledge the scourge of terrorism. And ultimately, when on January 6, 2004, for the first time in more than 60 years, Pakistan president undertook an agreement with Prime Minister Bajpayee that Pakistan undertakes not to sponsor terrorism from its soil against India. That's also a hard fact. We demitted office there. But thereafter, the point is, a consistent image needs to go that this far and no further. If we describe Pakistan as a victim of terrorism, if we say terrorism will go and business as usual will go, I'm sorry, that is not the right image.
Mr. Sarabji, you seem to want to add a point there. Yes, if you don't press the mic, I think it will work, yes.
I don't understand this expression, soft. I don't want to go in semantics. How would you define soft? I think softness should not be confused with patience, with recognition of hard realities, of what we can or cannot do. By hard realities, I mean we have our neighbor on one side and China on the other side. Now, I don't think when it comes to taking decisions it need to be taken in national interest, there's any softness. I defended Porter. Porter was upheld. Well, let me tell you, there was widespread misuse of Porter in respect of minority communities. Now, if we repeal a law which has been perceived to be and has in fact been abused in certain cases, that's not being soft. Provided we replace it under the law without those particular provisions which led to its abuse. So I think this debate about soft and all that is very subjective, depends on what is soft. I would say a nation is not soft when it doesn't compromise on its essential principles in foreign policy. Adjustments you have to make. You believe in diplomacy. You have to be patient. But I don't think we can be said to be soft because we don't take extremist actions and knee-jerk actions in face of provocations.
I'll pick you up on that point, knee-jerk actions, but Mr. Singhvi wants to respond.
No, I've had my say, but just to very quickly react to the two points made by my friend Ravi. You know, this soft-hard issue, you don't have to be tom-tomming a jingoistic badge on your sleeve to be called not a soft state. There's a difference between tom-tomming something and being focused. You can be respecting human rights, have democracy, have openness, and you can be firm. The two examples he gave, just look carefully. The first is based on the fallacy that a law like POTA reduces, prevents terrorism. If you see the statistics, two very startling things emerge. One point made by Soli just now, the largest number of, the conviction rate was abysmal. The largest amount of misuse. But more than that, Akshardham, Raghunath Mandir, Parliament attack, I don't know, the litany of events happened during POTA. And ironically, subsequent to the repeal of POTA, the actual number of serious terrorist incidents have come down. So don't put that direct nexus that because you Tom is a strong government, we have Pota, you are going to be able to control something. And the second example, would Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad consider the NDA government to be a soft state? Because you had the bus trip to Pakistan, followed by Kargil, and then despite Kargil, you had Agra, and then you had the parliament attack. This is real life. You can't just sit back sulking in a corner, even though you know Pakistan is. You can be tough with them, but this is not soft state. This is being realistic and dealing with the issues of selfish national self-interest where you can.
Okay, I'm tempted to actually hand the mic back to Mr. Prasad, but I won't. I'll go across to Mr. Salve. Mr. Salve, the point's been made by Mr. Sarabji that you cannot be knee-jerk in your response. Now, if several parties in opposition would have it their way, you would not have ties with Sri Lanka. You'd probably have no ties with Maldives. You would proscribe Italy. You would snap ties with Pakistan. You'd be on the way to autarky. In your opinion, do you believe that the Indian government handled adequately the Italian Marine case, for instance?
Let's step back and deal with the basic problem. We are a soft state because countries, big or small, push you around with impunity. Nobody takes you seriously. Let's not beat about the bush.
Illustrate the
knee-jerk reaction or no knee-jerk reaction. See, political, global political power flows either from the barrel of your gun, the size of your treasury, or the adeptness of your political system and your government. And we lack all three. And even your small neighbors who may today be worried about the size of your gun or may be attracted by the size of your treasury have abiding faith in your political system that they will fumble when the time comes. So, because let me tell you the importance of the good political system. Farid, in his book on the post-American world, makes a wonderful point. He says, look at Britain of 1901. When Queen Victoria died, he quotes Arnold Toynbee, who said that he was sitting on his uncle's shoulders watching the funeral of Queen Victoria. And you realize the might of the English Empire. And what were they? They just positioned themselves brilliantly. And why do we always find ourselves positioned that you're being kicked right from China, who's bigger than you, to Malay, who's a speck somewhere in the distance? I think we need to turn back and take a hard look and reinvent our architecture of where we have gone wrong. So it's not a question of knee-jerking or not knee-jerking. We are not taken seriously. And that's the more fundamental point which we need to address.
But the same author in the same book also warns against going the Chinese way. And all the three boxes that you've tech-marked, he says China is guilty of projecting power and making its neighbors apprehensive. So a lot of people in the literal of China, the literal zone of China in Southeast Asia, is actually nervous of China, see it as an aggressor, and perhaps bend more towards India as a natural ally, and therefore India gets its way through. That's the counter argument, Mr. Sarve, in a flat.
I've not seen India getting its way through very much. People are very happy when you give them tax payments in which they make money. People are very happy when you send food to them. People are very happy when you write them. But when you tell Malay do something, it turns around and growls at you. So that's how much people take India seriously. See, I think we need to reinvent the architecture of our foreign policy. Yes, I do not suggest we go all the way like China does, or even the United States does. But the fact of the matter is, to be believed, to be taken seriously, there is something which you have to do, and what we lack, we have to make up by adept political leadership. And I once again tell you, take the example of Great Britain, especially in the earlier part of the 20th century. Small little nation, little island nation. See how they positioned themselves. So we are in a position, we are the biggest democracy in our region. Why have we, where we failed in positioning ourselves? The whole world, we should have got public opinion to revolt against Pakistan. We failed signally in that. But there's something going wrong. Why is it that the greatest democracy, the biggest democracy in the world, is beaten up by Pakistan terrorism and nobody reacts?
Okay, let me bring in Mr. Sibal. Important points made by Mr. Salve. Some of them, of course, many people would view with some amount of circumspection. If you want to send out a message, as Mr. Salve says, and we could take the example of the Italian Marine case, do you think this government will arrest the Italian envoy if it came to it?
I hope not. That would.
Well, that's a visible symbol.
That will
don't
be a
mess
very,
with us.
Very serious error. It'll be contrary to international law. We'll put ourselves totally in the wrong, and we'll be accused of questioning the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations and sabotaging it, because this will create a terrible precedent. This is a road which we simply must not go down. The only practical thing that we can do is to expel the Italian ambassador and freeze our official contacts with Italy. And to the extent that there are official business contacts, those can be frozen too. They are involved in large defense projects in India. We have to take a very careful decision whether we exclude them and what it would cost us to exclude them. But tinkering with the Vienna Convention will actually bring the entire world onto our heads, and we'll put ourselves morally completely in the wrong. Today, the Italians are morally in the wrong because the Italian ambassador and Italian government gave assurances to the Supreme Court of India that these two Marines would return. They have no case. They cannot justify what they are doing. But if we actually escalate matters, that we begin tinkering with an international convention, which goes far beyond India-Italy relations, I think we will be stirring up a very serious hornet's nest, and we'll be putting ourselves in a totally indefensible position.
Well, immediately there is tension, because Mr. Salve on your left says, make a stand, take a stand, make a point and an example out of this individual, tell the world that you can't mess with us. Mr. Salve, that's a completely different point of view. That's the point of view of a Mandarin who has served his time in South Bloc, and you're a legal eagle who's fighting the case and recused himself in disgust.
Let me tell you what my position is, and I'm not being dogmatic about it. This is my personal opinion. The position of a diplomat or a country who is being sued is very different from the position of a diplomat who has petitioned. You cannot say, I will move your court, I will take relief from your court, but when my turn comes to pay, I have diplomatic immunity. There is a waiver, and our Supreme Court will decide whether moving the Supreme and giving not an assurance, but giving what we lawyers call an undertaking to the highest court in your personal capacity, clearly worded, saying, take responsibility. Whether you can, when it comes to fulfilling that responsibility, waive the Vienna Convention at the court. That's a matter the Supreme Court will decide. I personally don't think that stands in the way. The situation is unprecedented. Should we deal with him firmly? Yes. Should we send him to jail? I don't know whether that will serve any purpose or not. But some message has to be sent. The first message has been sent. The Supreme Court has said he will not leave the shores of India. So I think if the highest court of India says, if you come to my country, look at what happened to Strauss Kahn. He showed the Americans his diplomatic passport. They said, sorry, you've committed a crime. In America, there are so many instances where if you appear in a traffic court and then waive diplomatic immunity, they say, sorry, no, you have now appeared in our court. Here, he was a petitioner. He petitioned the court. He sought relief. He got relief. When the time comes for him to deliver, he can't say diplomatic immunity. Now, that's a question that the Supreme Court will decide. It's an unprecedented situation, and where this is going to end up. And I personally feel, and this is my big anguish, this has been the biggest setback to the development of public international law. What a gesture of cooperation of countries it was, that India had faith in the Italian Republic and it sent its people abroad. Today, what are we back with? Everybody, including all the TV channels, all anchors, okay. Commentators are saying, don't trust anybody.
Well, India might have not stirred the hornet's nest, but you certainly have. Three individuals on our panel waiting to rebut you. Let me first begin with Mr. Sarabji. Mr. Sarabji.
I'm substantially in agreement with what Harish said. But one thing, Kaval, you said it's not acceptable what the Italian government did. Please see the bare facts. There is no obligation on India under any law, national or international, to permit the Marines to go abroad. Therefore, the ambassador came to the court. He pleaded, he requested, he wanted a concession. Please let them go. And the Supreme Court did that on the face of his undertaking. Mind you, undertaking is not an agreement, not agreed to do. Undertaking has a certain implications, certain connotations. It's a commitment, it's a promise made to court that I will do it. And even after obtaining the benefit, you turn around and say, I won't do that. It's nothing short of being a fraud of the court and bringing the judicial institution into disrepute. And that we must save. On that we can't be soft. No one can mess around with our Supreme Court, however high may be or whatever nation may belong to. Now, to what extent do we put that into practice? Proportionality, wisdom must guide our choice. No using arrest him. I don't think it serves any purpose. We must send the message. If you give an undertaking to our court, forget your red herrings about arbitration and jurisdiction. Comply with it. That's all. And if you don't do it, you suffer the consequences. I'm sure, but there's a Supreme Court is firm. Now I hope the government does not shilly-shally, as I found in a debate with certain former diplomats, that this would result in this, that would result in that. Forget your Vienna Convention. We are concerned with the majesty and authority of the Supreme Court, okay. And we must maintain it.
Dr. Singhvi, government mustn't shilly-shally, as look, Mr. Sarabji says.
I think we have to start with the recognition that most unfortunately, something as high as the apex court has been clearly taken for a ride on the basis of a faith and assurance. And I think if an apex court can be taken for a ride, lesser mortals certainly can be and have been. Now, I think a good beginning has been made yesterday with the government moving to keep this person from leaving. This is obviously a personal opinion, there is no party opinion on this, and ultimately it's for government to take, but I think we should consider and leverage a contradiction here, which can be interesting and a good occasion to show that India is not and doesn't want to be seen as a soft state. At the diplomatic level, there is a move and there is a reason to make him persona non grata, and he's probably waiting for that to be sent off. But at the legal level, in view of his breach of undertaking, he can continue to be restrained from leaving the country. And I see no reason why we shouldn't do both. Both at the diplomatic level, convey that anger by making him persona non grata, and continue with the injunction, because that's a separate issue between him and the Supreme Court. And he cannot leave the country till that is decided.
I think like
that is both embarrassment and punishment, and achieves the occasion of showing that we are not a soft state.
I like the way, sir, from day one, when you appeared on our show, headlines today, the government is very relieved that the ball is in the court's hands. That's the sense one got. Mr. Sibal.
I think we are picking up absolutely the wrong issue to demonstrate that we are not a soft state. Let me actually say that if the Italian ambassador were to assassinate the Chief Justice of India, he still cannot be arrested and put behind bars. He has sovereign diplomatic immunity. He represents the Italian state. This is the law. Supreme Court cannot redefine an international convention. It has no power to do so. And if it does so, we'll bring the entire world at our doors. We will protest against this rewriting of an international convention unilaterally by the Supreme Court of India. Now, insofar as immunity is concerned, the Italian government has to expressly waiver the diplomatic immunity of the ambassador. Diplomatic immunity cannot be inferred from the actions of the ambassador.
No, you're presuming that the Italian state is a soft state.
No, number two, there are two stages of the diplomatic immunity waiver. One is when actually a person gets involved in proceedings, which is what has happened. Then in terms of the execution of the judgment, a second express waiver has to be issued by the government in question before the decision can be executed. So even in this case, the Supreme Court issues a restraint order. It does not apply to the Italian ambassador. You cannot physically restrain him. Supposing he goes to the airport and wants to leave the country, what would you do? Have the police manhandle him and stop him? The only thing you can do at that stage is to quickly prepare an expulsion order, sir, and expel him from the country. That's the only thing you can do. Sir. And we should not engage in legal adventurism on this issue. I'm saying this in full cognizance of the fact that we have legal luminaries of the highest standing of the country who are there, but I'm willing to make my point that they are on the wrong track.
Well, the distance between South Block and the Supreme Court is short, but the understanding of the law might actually lead you to be outflanked by four luminaries who have a very different take.
I have a quick comment to make.
Then I come to Mr. Ravi.
I think this matter of the extent of diplomatic immunity is not going to be defined by the diplomats. It's going to be defined by the court. And diplomats better know, if they come into our national court, if they give undertakings to our national court, it is our national court who will deal with them and decide the contours of its powers, not diplomatic conventions.
Okay, and Mr. Prasad. Mr. Prasad, enough.
Well, I tend to agree with Harish. It is a very unprecedented situation where a diplomat himself was the petitioner. He gave the undertaking. And you need to see that undertaking, how very clearly what it is. But I'm on a more fundamental issue. How this mess has been created. What was the stand of the government of India before the court? Did the government of India object? To the best of my knowledge, there was a nodding approval by the government of India lawyer. Is an Indian detained in New York or London is given the right to come to India to celebrate Diwali or Eid or from the Gulf countries? All right, one gesture I can understand that they were given the permission to go to celebrate Christmas. But the right to vote? Why did not the government of India lawyer strongly object in the Supreme Court? And I'm sure if there was a strong objection, this order would not have been passed. And I regret to say the Supreme Court ought to have been a little more cautious before permitting Italian to exercise the luxurious right to vote for 6 weeks far away in Italy. It will have consequences. But let me conclude my last point because I need to respond to Abhishek. Abhishek, yes, on the issue of terrorism, we need to work unitedly. The law against rape is there on the statute book for so long. But we are trying to strengthen the laws. We are debating that in view of what happened in Delhi. Can we have a different yardstick in the case of terrorism? Yes, those who committed the heinous attack on India, attack on Parliament, were convicted because of POTA so early, and you took 8 years to give the final punishment. Therefore, instruments, power, empowerment, and giving a sense of courage to our security forces, the nation is behind you.
But sir,
and I'm sorry to say, that doesn't happen if you have so many debates as to here happened what.
But
who
on
dies
that point,
for the country?
What about AFSPA? Huh? You have a situation where today, the people of two states are looking to the political parties to come to a conclusion so that this occupation by force, as it's described in these two states, ends.
Well, I'm very happy.
Yet, both political parties play politics. The state of Tripura, and I don't know if our audience knows this, was the worst affected by terrorism. Terrorism is ended in Tripura, as we know it, but AFSPA still continues, and it's a temporary measure. Sir.
Well, forces need protection or not? In fact, I would respond this question by a more fundamental question. Who dies for the country? It's the most difficult choice. Now, when forces go to take on terrorism or their patrons, it is a life-threatening situation. And there have been cases that when security forces undertake these kind of counterattacks, there have been implications. I'm always saying if any force is involved in some kind of a rape attempt or other things, go all, take action, punish him. On the human rights issue also, I'm with you, what you raised. But we need to flag one issue. Human rights only of the aggressors or have a consideration for human rights of the victims of terrorism. The families also have a right about those who have been killed, innocent Indians. Therefore, on this issue, I would say, Rahul, the view of the security forces and the ground reality needs to be taken. Namely, in such a hostile situation, security forces are implicated in a series of cases. You know, case in Kashmir, there was an allegation of rape. It was found to be false. There was some protection is needed. But yes, if a situation like Tripura is there, there can be a consideration for revoking it in a particular circumstances. But you cannot say that security forces do not need some kind of a cover of law like the Armed Forces Special Power Act.
Mr. Sarabji, you wanted to make a point.
Well, I'm only concerned with one thing, that our Supreme Court should not be soft. its own majesty, its own prestige is involved. And I'm not too sure whether an offense of contempt of court, which is a sua generis sort of offense, it's not an offense under Indian Penal Code, not an offense under any other statutory law, whether an offense of this kind, which is sua generis, is covered by the convention. But I don't know. That's a matter for debate. But one thing I want to say, and if I may say it in the light of vain, Ravi said, why didn't the government of India object strongly? But do they know when Harish is on the other side, what do? They're made pulp by his eloquent advocacy. And the worst part of the matter is that Mr. Salve was also taken for a ride. And he very honorably has refused to appear for the Italian government, for which I congratulate him. So let's take it in the total context.
Right.
Not any one particular incident, the totality, but one thing, sense of proportion must guide all our actions, governments and the Supreme Court.